Speaking of sleep, when you wake up early, you might be able to see something pretty fascinating. A lot of us look up and see the moon, and the upcoming moon will give us a special show, the second and the largest supermoon of the year, and a lunar eclipse. A lot going on. Here to talk about why the moon is so special and the ongoing efforts to get back there, NASA expert Jim Garvin. NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center Chief Scientist. Ooh, just learned how to talk, Jim. Bear with me this morning. Here's the thing. I know that Hawaii is a great place to be most times and ground zero when it comes to seeing this blood red supermoon. Are we going to be able to see it here?
Not really. We'll just see a little partial, unfortunately, Steve. But anything west of the Mississippi, you'll start to get good views, particularly, of course, if it's clear.
And if we do catch that glimpse, what's the best time to catch that?
I think the best place to do is watch it from the www.nasa.gov/moon. And our Twitter site, it will give everyone the exact timing when it's best to see tonight. And I think you can also watch on the web. There's lots of places where people will be capturing the great events. And of course, in Hawaii and the South Pacific.
So, Jim, we've gotten used to the supermoon and just to see how large the moon appears to us. What makes this one blood red? Where's that red color come from?
It's actually coming from the sun's light passing through the Earth's atmosphere as the Earth shadows the moon. It's really special. Our atmosphere is a lens of all this cool stuff. We live in it, of course, and that's good, but it also makes the moon get this bronze blood red color, which is kind of cool. It almost looks like Mars, but it's the moon.
But that's only for a few minutes, right?
That's right. It's because of the time it takes for the moon to pass through the Earth's shadow, which is shadowing the sun. Tonight, I should say today, it's only a little over 14 minutes. Sometimes it's up to half an hour. So it's not a lot of time, but it's a special event because it shows you how the ballet of the Earth and Moon works. It's kind of cool.
All right, one more quick question about this. If we do miss it, and it looks like here on the East Coast, we will likely miss it with the naked eye, when will it happen again?
I think there's several more supermoons coming up this year, but this particular geometry with the eclipse and the supermoon won't happen for several years.
Okay, all right. Well, if you can check it out, check it out. Now, let's talk about the moon itself. Plans to get back there. If I go back to my hometown, which is a small town, Jim, things haven't changed much in the last 30 years or so. Do we think things have changed on the moon once we get back there?
Oh, absolutely, because we're going to go to new places. Just like your hometown's cool, my hometown's cool, there's other hometowns we haven't been to. So on the moon, we're going to go with people, women and men, to the polar regions. At the South Pole, there are places that we think there's frozen water in the ground, minerals we can use to make things. The moon's going to come alive as a place where people can go, live, work, and enjoy.
So let me ask this question that comes from some critics out there saying, if the moon is, I'll dumb this down, if the moon is all that, why have we not gone back in 50 years?
Because we've been doing a lot of stuff, Steve. I mean, here on Earth, we have come a ways in 50 years, and notwithstanding the Super Bowls and all those other great events, but we've also learned stuff. And we've been exploring the universe, the Hubble Space Telescope, an international space station, women and men there now. We have two giant rovers on Mars, driving around looking for signs of that habitable past. We're going to be going to Jupiter's moon Europa, studying our Earth, studying the sun with Parker Solar Probe. We've been busy, and now we're ready to go back with better technology, smarter, more commercial links, so we can send women to the moon and learn to be sustainable there. That's going to be a new era.
The fascination with space has always been there, and it does continue. If we look, and we want to take a look at that big picture, life on the moon, if we set up a colony on the moon, do you think, first of all, that it would happen? And second of all, if so, a rough time frame for that?
Well, our Artemis program is going to start the ball rolling, Steve. And so we're hoping to set up an Artemis base camp where women and men will work on the moon with robot support, linking to the people here in the United States, around the world. And what comes next is going to be in the hands of the people of the planet. Do we want to start living there like we do at the South Pole of the Earth in Antarctic, McMurdo, or other places? That's in the hands of beyond what we're doing. We're getting the ball rolling there like we did with Apollo over 50 years ago. We'll open the frontier and then the people will go.
You and I probably won't have this conversation in 50 years, but somebody else will. And when they chat 50 years from now, do you think there will be people on the moon living there?
Oh, I dearly hope so. I think we're putting in motion all the pieces. NASA's enjoyed great support from the American people. I think we're ready to go. And once we figure out the moon, we'll be ready to go to Mars. All and right. that will be historic.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. The fascination's still there. NASA's Jim Garvin, thanks for joining us this morning.
Thanks, Steve.